there was nothing at all particular about the knock around the door.
Except that it was very large.
It is also a fact that Scrooge had seen it, night and morning, during his whole residence in that place.
Also, that Scrooge had as little as what is called fancy about him as any man in the City of London.
Let it also be borne in mind that Scrooge had not bestowed one thought on Marley since his last mention of his 7 years dead partner that afternoon.
And let any man explain to me, if he can, how it happened that Scrooge, having his key in the lock of the door, saw not a knocker, but
Marley's face.
It had a dismal look about it, like a bad lobster in a dark cellar.
It was not angry or ferocious, but looked at Scrooge as Marley used.
Scrooge looked at it.
It was a knock.
He put his hand upon the key he had relinquished, turned it sturdily, and walked in.
But before he shut the heavy door, he walked through his rooms to see that all was right.
He had just enough recollection of
Marley's face.
Desire.
Nobody under the chair.
Nobody under the bed.
Nobody in his dressing gown, which was hanging up in a suspicious attitude against the wall.
Humbug.
Quite satisfied, he closed the door and locked himself in. Double locked himself in, which was not his custom.
Scrooge threw his head back into the chair. His glance happened to rest upon a bell that was hung
in the room.
It was with great astonishment and with a strange, inexplicable dread that as he looked, he saw this bell begin to swing. It swung so softly in the outset that it scarcely made a sound, but soon it rang out loudly and started everywhere.
Because a little thing can affect them. Slight
disorder of the stomach. You may be an undigested bit of beef, a block of mustard, a crumb of cheese, a fragment of an undercooked potato, where there's more of gravy than of gravy about you, whatever you are.
It was as heavy and as long as this 7 Christmas Eves ago. You have labored on it since. It is a ponderous chain.
Jacob! Jacob, Marley, tell me more! Speak to comfort me, Jacob.
I have none to give. Nor can I tell you what I would. A very little more is permitted me. I cannot rest. I cannot stay, I cannot linger anywhere. No rest, no peace, incessant torture of remorse.
You have always been a good man of business.
Business? Mankind was my business. The common welfare, my business. Charity, mercy, forbearance, benevolence. These were all my business. The dealings of my trade were but a drop of water in a comprehensive ocean of my business. It's this time of year I suffer most. Why did I walk through crowds of fellow beings with my eyes turned down and never once raised them towards that blessed star which led the wise men to a poor abode? Were there no poor homes its light might have conducted me? Hear me, my time is short.
I will, but don't be too hard upon me, Jacob. Don't be flattery, Jacob.
Should be plumb over there.
I am here to visit you tonight to warn you that you have yet a chance and hope of escaping my fate. A chance and hope of my procurement, Ebenezer.
You were always a good friend to me, Jacob. Thank you.
You will be haunted by 3 spirits.
Is this by chance that, is this the chance that hope you speak of, Jane?
It is.
I'd rather not.
Without their visit, you cannot hope to shut the pack I tread. Expect the first ghost tomorrow when the bell tolls 1.
There we go.
Couldn't I just have them all as once and be done with it, Jane?
Expect the second on the next night. Same hour, the third upon the next night when the last stroke of 12 has ceased to vibrate. Look to see me no more, and look that, for your own sake, you remember what has passed between us.
Home! Home!
The hour is